morning to all of you. Say it in loud voice. Good morning. Thank you very much. And most respected Dr. Gupta, J.L. Gupta, a very legendary figure in the field of education. You just heard his very thought-provoking discourse, and he dispensed wisdom. The homegrown wisdom, not alien to my country. He spoke so very well, I was mesmerized. I was completely impressed the way he steered through different paths, treaded different paths, and told you the right path and how to be on the righteous path. What is righteousness? Dharma. Dharma is known as righteousness. And I'll take further on, taking cue from his brilliant lecture. How many of you have read the letter addressed by the 16th President of the United States of America, Abraham Lincoln, to the headmaster of a school? How many of you have read that letter? How many of you have read that letter? People coming from convent background must have read that Abraham Lincoln's famous letter to the headmaster of a school where his own son was schooling. None of you? You have read. Okay, very good. So can you? You will not be able to remember it. Okay. So Abraham Lincoln says, it's far more honorable to fail than to cheat. It's far more honorable to cheat. It's far more honorable to fail. It's far more honorable to fail than to cheat. There's no shame in tears. But teach my son to sell his brain and brawn to the highest bidder, but never to put a price tag on his heart and soul. That voice of the conscience which he was referring to, the voice of the conscience, it always tells you which is the right path to tread upon. Teach my son, if you can, to sell his brain brawn to the highest bidder, but never to put a price tag on his heart and soul. Teach my son is far more honorable to. A dollar earned is of far more value. A dollar earned is of far more value than the five found. You found somewhere few dollars and you rejoice and be happy. As Professor Gupta was narrating you, yes, everything was coming. And the way he landed up in the police station, he couldn't run faster, and the parents, in order to give him a little bit of insight into life, make him run and run and run so that he can compete. Abraham Lincoln says, even a scoundrel has a hero. Even a scoundrel has a hero. So you need to better up your skills, you know, each time in every field, even in the field of scoundrels. There's a competition everywhere. Even a scoundrel has a hero. After every selfish politician, there's a dedicated leader. Teach my son to hear all that he wants to hear, but please advise him to filter what he hears on the screen of truth and accept only what is true and reject the rest. But don't cuddle my son too much, because only the test of fire that makes a fine steel. Cuddling too much, showering you all affection, loving you. Oh, my children, you are very, very beautiful children. You are very nice children, very obedient children. Your conduct is very ideal, worth appreciating. But it's just the opposite. And Professor Gupta likes some shayari, so I'll just say, ek galti hum jindagi bhar karte rahe. Ek galti hum jindagi bhar karte rahe. Dhool chehre pe thi aur hum aina saaf karte rahe. Dhool chehre pe thi. एक गलती हम जिंदगी भर करते रहे, धूल चेहरे पे थी और हम आईना साफ करते गए. यू ऑलवेज स्टार्ट यू नो डूइंग जस्ट द अपोजिट ऑफ व्हाट योर कॉन्शियंस टेल्स यू. इट्स अ क्लींजिंग ऑफ योर सेल्फ. नाउ आई आस्क अ फ्यू हार्ड क्वेश्चंस व्हिच प्रोफेसर गुप्ता मे नॉट हैव पोस्ड यू, बिकॉज आई हैव बीन अ लेजिस्लेटर सो आई नो ए लिटिल बिट ऑफ लॉ. How many of you read newspapers? Well, that's a large number. I'm very happy to know that. What are the headlines today? What are the headlines? Just one of you may stand who has read the headlines carefully. One of you may stand and tell me, what are the headlines about? Do the headlines refer to law and a legal point? Does it refer to? What are the headlines about? All of you have read newspaper. Do you have unread the headlines? What is making headlines now? Beg your pardon? You stand up here. I'll still go deeper into it. You come here. Yes, please tell all of them.
122nd Constitutional Amendment Bill passed with 100% majority.
What is GST?
Goods and Services Tax.
Good. You are qualified, but this is not the headline. The headline today is that Mr. Najib Jung wins and the Kejriwal government loses in the High Court. It refers to Article 239AA. How many of you know that there's an article 239AA article relating to the Union Territory of Delhi and as amended in the year 1991. A constitutional amendment was made and it is article 239AA which defines the powers of the Lieutenant Governor and the democratically elected government of the day. In the 239AA, there is a very clear demarcation of the powers that the Lieutenant Governor of Delhi enjoys. There are three subjects which are called reserved subjects. The police comes under the Lieutenant Governor. The land and building comes under the Lieutenant Governor. And the services department comes under the Lieutenant Governor. These are called reserved subjects and the rest are called transferred subjects, right? So the reserved subjects are reserved for the consideration of the Lieutenant Governor and the rest are to be deliberated, discussed and a final decision to be taken by the Council of Ministers. Today's judgment has really come as a deep shock. Because you have an electoral process in place. And democratically elected people, representatives, cannot manifest their will, shall have, perhaps, according to this judgment, will not have any say in the governance of the city. May that be related to your infrastructure, may that be with your electricity, may that be provision of roads, may that be provision of hospitals, may that be provision of anything, for everything the Council of Ministers has to approach the Lieutenant Governor of Delhi, which to my mind is absolutely undemocratic. Otherwise there's no point in having the elections year after year. After every 5 years you have hold the elections to the assembly and the elected representatives are divided of the powers which can deliver relief to the people. It's nothing, I can only term it as anti-democratic, but it's an interpretation, right? Remember you. It's an interpretation. I may be wrong. There will be opposite counsel also who will stand and say, no, you're wrong. Article 239AA defines the Lieutenant Governor's power. There's a transaction of business rules. which clearly states that the Lieutenant Governor is the final arbiter and final person who will take it final decision. Even if the Council of Ministers differs with that decision, the decision taken by the Lieutenant Governor will be final. It's something which you have to debate as the budding lawyers in future. And there are very many things, you know. There are so many laws made. But how about those laws being implemented as on ground? There's an anti-Dowry Act, there's a consumer protection law, and so on and so forth. There's so many. We have been legislating in this country. In fact, if I may say so, 365 days of Parliament does nothing, passing new legislations which do not really affect a common man's life, which doesn't touch a common man's life. So how do you remedy it? So long as you're not thinking mind, if you're not thinking as a lawyer, you're supposed to know much more than the opposite counsel and the judge itself. So what is required is a vociferous reading. You need to be an ardent reading. You have to be very keen readers, intensive reading, and extensive troubling widens the horizons of your knowledge. You need to do intensive reading. If you don't read literature, the judgments written will be very dull and drab and may not add substance or the soul to a judgment. The judgments are of far-reaching consequences. Professor Gupta was referring to as to what is good and what is bad. To me, a simple definition comes very handy. What takes you Godward is good, and what takes you away from God is bad. And there is another simple formula I'll give you. As you start walking east, you'll be farther from the west. As you start doing good work, noble work, you'll be distancing yourself from the wicked things in life. Of course, the mind is the biggest solicitor or advocate or that I've ever found. The mind will justify anything, any wrongdoing by you. Like the student whom Professor Gupta was referring to is nothing but finding justification for your every wrongdoing, because you don't have a system through which you can do a very critical introspection, and you often tend to indulge into things which are wrong and which do not really justify the manner in which you are conducting your lives. So what is fundamental to you is to know what is just, what is unjust. What is fair and what's not so fair? What's so truthful and what is not so truthful? Because truth always triumphs finally. Whatever manipulations you may do, whatever cheatings you may do, but finally let me tell you that wickedness is going to come and rebound 1,000-fold to you, and maybe your life becomes very miserable. So values in life are going to help you in good stead. So value system is something which is being taught along with the law. There are very many law students who have seen, they give a perverse logic. They won't give the correct logic. They'll always try to find the client, even if the client is on the wrong path. Only one barrister I could find in history who refused to take a brief because the person approaching him had committed some heinous crime and his conscience never allowed him to take that brief, and that was Karamchand Gandhi, Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi, when he was practicing in Johannesburg in South Africa as a barrister at law. He said, nothing doing, I cannot argue your case because you have committed a heinous crime. So be conscience keepers. Look within and find out what is right and what is wrong. And the idea of doing all this is to, our legal system is made like you want to reform things. You don't want to punish people. And one in 1,000 cases which where there is not even the remote. You see, the accused is always given the benefit of doubt. One man should not be hanged for the wrong reason. 99.9% reckoning, they will see that an accused, if he has the benefit of doubt, the accused will be acquitted because his human rights get violated. The human rights have got to be protected under all conditions and situations. But remember, you have a mind too. But beyond mind, there's a conscience. There's a soul within each one of you. There are very many soul-stirring experiences when we found people lawyering in Supreme Courts and High Courts. The most shocking thing is that most of the brilliant lawyers give a perverse logic to prove that their client is innocent, and thus the client gets acquitted, and subsequent to which a number of series of crimes, there are serious killers, you know, there are a lot of people who are psychopaths and maniacs, and they indulge into one act repeatedly, and they want to say, because the law is so loose and that it can be twisted, interpreted in a manner that you want to do it, right? So you have to be very conscientious lawyers, and you have to always uphold your conscience and say, no, I'm not going to do a wrong thing. Come what may, whatever may be the pressures, whatever may be the temptations, you will overcome those temptations. I was telling about 239AA, and this article really has done more injustice to the people of Delhi than doing justice. The people's will cannot manifest itself. Elected government cannot do anything without the sanction of the Lieutenant Governor of Delhi, which is not the spirit of the Act. The spirit of the Act does a very clear demarcation. Departments like education, PWD, any other thing which has something to do with the public welfare shall be dealt with publicly elected representatives, and a few things like enforcement of law and order and land and distribution like DDA and many land owning agencies, those are coming under the direct consideration of the Lieutenant Governor. So it has to be understood, it has to be interpreted. But remember this, you need to have critical thinking. That spirit of inquiry must not die in you. You should always be trying to know, you should have quest for knowledge. And that quest for knowledge will come when you read a lot. Understand things from your perspective, and then if your perspective is wrong, you can always have that corrected with the assistance of our learned faculty members. They are all repositories of knowledge. They are all brilliant people. They are not greenhorns like you. They are experienced people. But all those who deserve will stand to benefit. All those who want to avoid teachers, avoid attending classes, then remember you. One day you'll come to your grief and say, sorry, I couldn't do well, and I couldn't be a good lawyer, but because you haven't learned anything. You have to equip yourself with highly superior knowledge. We have got the best law online. So if some people go for mooting abroad or in our own country, they can access with a password the best laws, which gives you a plethora of judgments and which gives you a lot of information on different laws that this country has enacted so far. The parliamentary initiative is almost dying in this country. What is parliamentary initiative? What do the parliamentarians do? They make laws, right? But can you imagine which is this Lok Sabha now going on? Is this a 16th Lok Sabha or 17th Lok Sabha? I'll give you a cue. Tell me, which is this, you know, after each five years there's the parliamentary election take place. In 16 terms of parliament, we didn't have the members of parliament of the caliber to create a piece of legislation, which finally finds a place in the statute book. Are you getting me? It is the honorable members of parliament who have the right on Friday, every Friday, is reserved as a private member's business. You know, private member's business means the private members privately, in their own right as members of parliament, can pilot a bill on the floor of the House on Friday. Friday is a private member's business day. So any member of parliament who has the brilliance and the insight into a particular social problem, they can stand up and say, I want to pilot this bill, place it on the table of the House. Up till this time, till the 9th Lok Sabha, when I studied the parliamentary proceedings, it came to my light that only 9 members of parliament were competent to make piece of legislation, and those legislative bills, those bills, private members' bill, they found a place in the statute book. It's a history. You should go to the Parliament House library. If you want to be good and brilliant lawyers, you should go to the Parliament House library. I can even help you in accessing the Supreme Court library, which is one of the richest libraries, which judges often refer to those books for interpretation of law before coming to a judgment. So it's a very delicate, it's a very tender job, it's a very human job when you become lawyers. Remember one thing, never ever disappointment come anywhere near you. Many times you argued the case well, you had the best of presentation before the division bench or before the single bench judge, but at the end of the day, the case may go against you. For various reasons, the case may go against you. Maybe your arguments didn't have merit. Maybe you have missed out certain points which you ought to have mentioned. So even if you lose, remember it. Even from failure, you have to learn to stand and to reframe your arguments and to redo your draft and your plaint, and then again go to the same court or the higher court for revision of the judgment. Many times I have seen people who, in spite of the failure in the lower court, they go and get the relief from the. So you need to be tenacious. You must have perseverance, patience, and foresight. No, I need to know more than the opposite counsel and more than what the judge knows. That can only happen when you have so much of you amass so much of information which is far superior than the rest of the people. So WIPS is now not competing in terms of gold medals. For the last 4 or 5 years, we have been begging the gold medal of the university. We have been university gold medalist. In School of Journalism also, we have been regularly holding positions. 37 odd students from here, WIPS, they passed out and they became judges. Even now, we have a lot many judges in the Tisdari courts and Karkaruma courts and different 9 courts in Delhi. We have most of our students here who make us proud, who make us feel gratified, and it gives us so much of joy, because Abraham Lincoln said, teach my son the secret of quiet laughter. What is quiet laughter? When you enjoy your success, when you take contentment in your accomplishments, you say, here I am, I have reached this place. So I just want to tell you, the budding lawyers, you need focus and you need to remain focused always. You need not be thinking any other thing except law and its various interpretations. By simply misinterpreting an article or misinterpreting the law or the failure in presenting your case, you can miss a lot. Once you lose a client, you lost the business, your source of livelihood. No person would like to hand over his life to a bad doctor or to a good lawyer. Why is law so essential? In Professor Madhav Menon, who was a legendary figure as a teacher, he stood too tall amongst the teaching community who was teaching law and who became the founder, director of National Law School, Bangalore. He said, law governs human conduct. Law governs human conduct from the cradle to the crematorium. How far is it justified? Law governs human conduct from the cradle to the crematorium. What is cradle? Each one of you must have spent some time in cradle. You were born grown. All of you must have spent some time in your cradle. But remember, the parents are mindful of the fact that if I don't obtain a birth certificate as required under the law, my child is not going to get admission in school. So very basic, you know, the law stream is so very basic, it equips you with the latest information as to what all you need to do, what are the legal formalities, what are the legal requirements. So when he says, law governs human conduct from the cradle to the crematorium. When you die, a death certificate becomes an essential, it is a necessity to obtain it for succession of property and other rights. So law governs human conduct from the cradle to the crematorium. Law has a very vast expanse of application. It has very vast applications, let me tell you. It almost touches every facet of life. Atrocities against the downtrodden, atrocities against women, exploitation of women, women empowerment, we have to enable them, and there is proper legislation to that effect. Dowry was a menace here in this country, now it is becoming lesser. And so many things, you need to have the sensitivity. Samvedana hoti na, ek vedana hoti, ek samvedana hoti hai. Aapka hriday jo hai, usme nahi hai na vedana, to samvedana paida nahi ho sakti hai. When a client comes to you, he is in distress. He is in need of a good counsel, is a good advice, he needs accesses to the best of counselor. But remember you, if you lose four or five cases in a row, maybe one day you have to strive for your livelihood. The parents are sending you here thinking that it is one of the most appropriate place for imparting legal education. But legal education has to be taken in the right earnest. And yes, people gossiping there may quit. People gossiping in that quarter, the two ladies, you can do a walk the talk in our lawns, but not here. That means you don't want to take life seriously. You don't understand the implications of it. These words, I don't speak like that. I need to get connected with you. I should tell you what the law is all about. You can't laugh away anybody. You can't humiliate. You can't disrespect. You cannot show disrespect to your fellow beings. If you have the freedom of speech and freedom of movement, it cannot be abused. You have the freedom of speech. I cannot deliver an inflammatory speech to incite communal violence and to make one community fight against the other. There are corresponding duties. With each one of these fundamental rights, there are corresponding duties. You read those corresponding duties, how you need to behave as a citizen. What is required, what is expected of you as a citizen? This country lacks responsible citizenship. If you would have created responsible citizenship, you go to US, and even the president has done training in the army, he has been trained. Even the British Kingdom, even they are not exempted from joining army and serving the army for minimum 2 years. Why? Because you need to imbibe the sense of discipline. You need to discipline your mind. Unless and until you enforce discipline, you will never ever learn anything. You're handling people's lives, you know, you're playing with their lives. You're handling the trust of your client. How can you take the client's application lightly? You have to do a lot of research, do a lot of reading. You should know legal drafting, you should know client counseling, and you should know how to proceed and present the case before the court. This is what we are going to teach you here. But it's up to you how much you receive and how much you don't want to receive. You want to deny yourself the superior knowledge which you want to impart, you make you the best of people, make you the best of citizens, make you responsible judicial officers, make you qualify different competitive exams, even civil service. Many people can qualify civil service after doing their law. But they must understand law, what law is all about. Law is a very, very vast subject which touches almost every aspect of human life, and you have to have the right conduct. I always tell, this is written at different places, three things are expected of you. First requirement is right conduct. If your conduct is found to be wrong, we will not hesitate in seeing that you are out of this college. Ideal conduct. A conduct which people envy, yes, he is a man, boy with the strength of character, or she is a girl who stands by her conviction, and then only will come, once you have the right conduct, then will come the sense of duty. What's your duty to the citizens of India? What's your duty to your clients? What's your duty to your parents? What's your duty towards the teachers? So, right conduct, sense of duty, and then responsibility must come to you. The earlier it comes, the more soberly you will conduct yourself, and you will really be an ideal lawyer who will bring this institution proud. It will be proud of you. We want to have that kind of a feeling of joy within us. Yes, we are doing our job well, but you also on your part need to do your job well. It is not one-sided story. The teachers will come and deliver the lectures and you at home don't go and make a reading. Because it's a very, very demanding profession. If somebody thinks that I can idle around and in that black robe going around places and going 9 different district courts in Delhi, it's not all about lawyering. Lawyering is a deep study of the law. And then you need to research and to find out new laws, the new interpretations, the entire Supreme Court, High Court, and different judgments that have been delivered and which have now been taken the position of a law. It becomes law when the Supreme Court passes a particular thing. Right to food was not there earlier. Before the Kalahandi, deaths didn't take place because of starvation. Right to education became later. Which is this article that gives you, that empowers you right to education? The article? 21A. So right to education comes from Article 21A. Everything will stem from the Constitution. Right to food. Right to dignity. Dignity, human dignity. If you lose that, you have lost everything. And lawyers need to have interdisciplinary knowledge. You have to examine different people from different disciplines. Negligence at workplace is one. A patient dies on the table, on the operating table, and the client comes to you, my kith and kin died there because of the sheer negligence of the doctor. If you know not what the medical profession is all about and what all procedures could have been, you see, there is a surgical procedure. There's a laid down procedure. And if somebody has skipped any one of those things, you are playing with that life, and the doctor is liable to be punished. 304A, am I right? Death caused by negligence. So death can be caused by negligence of a doctor, but the negligence have got to be proved, and for proving that, you need to study the whole law, you need to study whole books of relating to medicine, and the surgical procedures prescribed. There's a book, Hughes Voluminous book, you know, it's called Love and Bailey's book of surgical procedures. You need to access that information and say, here it is, sir, written. These are the prescribes. This is the prescription. He went contrary to that. The anesthetist should have done his job. He has not done his job. The patient has died while in anesthesia. Cardiac arrest took place. Infarct in the brain took place. And the patient died because of the sheer negligence of the... You'll be able to prove only when you equip yourself with an interdisciplinary knowledge of medicine also. We had the conference here, the law and medicine. The AIMS director came here, the best of lawyers came here, the forensic experts came here. So lawyers are not going to limit themselves to different articles and sections, IPC and CRPC, but you also need to equip yourself with the interdisciplinary knowledge where you can prove your client's point by equipping yourself with the superior knowledge in that particular subject. So you have to be constantly reading. It's a very demanding profession. Anybody who doesn't go home, back home from the college and doesn't study for 3 to 4 hours regularly, 3 to 4 hours, I am telling you on the minimum side. People study even for 5 to 6 hours. Self-study is the key to success. Anybody who has done self-study at home will triumph. Will score higher marks and will also be rated as a good lawyer. Because there are so many layers of lawyers. You are at a junior level, you graduate to an advocate on record, then you become a senior designated, and there are very many people who want to be arguing lawyers only. They don't want any seniority, they just want to argue. And the knowledge is fabulous. The fabulous knowledge can only come through when you are fully focused and attentive during the class, and after the class is over, you don't shrug your shoulders and say, oh, it's a freedom. No, it's not freedom. It is incumbent on you to go home and study it. And it rests on your shoulders a great responsibility. For being good lawyers, you must go home and make a 4 to 5 hours of reading. I am not saying you should read only law books. You can read any other thing, but cultivate a habit of self-reading. Once you develop this self-reading habit every day, I can assure you, you will excel in the legal profession. And you should equip yourself. You should make friends in the medical profession. You should make friends in different departments and learn from them. Learn from them when the inquiries are conducted in the army. They're course, regular course. And then know how a junior officer has been tortured by a senior one. And how the orders were to the contrary than what was in the manual. There's a jail manual also. You can't maltreat even a prisoner. In the Punjab, you know, act, it is given. The jail manual is under as per the Punjab Act. And you read out that, you will not tolerate injustice. You will be highly sensitive, human person, because a lawyer has to be human. And those humanly qualities will only lead you to success. If you cease to be human, heartless person, no compassion, nothing, then remember, you will only be mechanically doing things, and you will not be, your heart and soul will not be involved in that. So my appeal to you will be, you being budding lawyers, you need to be very, very obedient to your teachers. You should be attending your classes regularly, and after the classes are over, go to the library. If there is any book short, you can just place a request with the dean. We will get you the best of books. We will get you the best online resources. But we want to see you shine in life. You must excel in life. You should not be seen to be in Karkaduma courts or Dwarka courts. Not that justice is not being dispensed there, but there is a low level of justice being dispensed there. You must familiarize yourself with the sessions court or the lower court. But after that, you have to go beyond that, and in high court, I mean, everything is decided within a couple of seconds. I mean, everything is decided. If you are on merit, your plaint is on merit, is well drafted, writ petition under Article 226, then your case is accepted. Otherwise, at the submission level only, admission level only, they will say no, it's not admitted. You want to withdraw this, or you want to refile this whole writ. So many times you exercise your discretion, say, no sir, I don't want to go with the wrong grounds, let me take new grounds and bring this writ again. Otherwise, foolish people, normally they press upon that point, and normally their writ petition get dismissed in default. In limine, when we say limine, means so many lacunas you left, so many loopholes you left. So my only request to you, my children, is that you better take legal studies seriously. And the right earnest, and at the bottom of your heart should be compassion, should be sensitivity, should be the commitment towards this profession. Then only you become good lawyers. We wish you all the best, and I can assure you, we will not leave any stone unturned so far as the institution is concerned. We would like to give you the best of facilities and the best of faculty to open up your minds as to how you need to think law all the time. You have to think of law all the time, different interpretations of law all the time. Just not close your minds and keep your books also, textbooks also closed. So you have to study the daily newspapers every day, because there are different cases being quoted, and there is a particular beat called legal beat. Different Supreme Court judgments are published the next day. And online every day, his judgments are brought live. You can read those judgments. What stand have the judges taken? Is it a division bench? Is it a constitutional bench? There are many things which have constitutional implications. And that you will only be able to know when you just open up your minds. Thank you very much.